Good morning, students. How are you? I hope you all are fine. Our third lesson is going. In last lecture, we discussed about the classification of plants according to the size and height of their stems. Plants can be classified into three types: trees, shrubs and herbs. The characteristics of the trees, characteristics of the shrubs and herbs with example we discussed already. Now next point, it is vines. Some vines need vertical support for growing while some others spread on the ground. What is the meaning of vines? Meaning of vines, it is nothing but the climbing plant. So it required a support. Climbers like the money plant have aerial roots. Have you seen the cucumber tendrils that look like a spring? Look at here. This is the structure of tendrils. Tendrils are nothing but the curling structure is there, that is called as the tendrils. What is the use of that tendrils? Tendrils are nothing but the leafy part of that climbers. Okay, and the main use of that is they give the support to the plant. Touch the stem of any vines, what do you feel? The stem of a creeper is very flexible, soft and green. It grows rapidly with the help of support. The growth is very fast, rapid growth is there, but they require the support for their proper growth. Look at here, watermelon, it is pumpkin, it is cucumber, this is the structure of money plant. So these are the examples of the climbers. Life cycle of plants like jowar, sunflower is completed in 1 year. These plants are called as the annuals. Annuals, that is nothing but the life cycle is completed in 1 year. The life cycle of plants like the carrot, beetroot is of 2 years. They are called as the biennials. Shrubs like the hibiscus or oleander and trees like mango and gulmohar live for several years and bear flowers and fruits. They are called as the perennials. So what is the bottom line? According to the period of their life cycle. Life cycle, that means when seedling is there, after that seedling proper growth of the plant is occur, development occur, and after that whatever the flowers or fruits they form on that plant. So very important one, please highlight these lines. Plants that bear flowers are called as the flowering plants, while the plants that never bear flower are called as the non-flowering plants. Non-flowering plants may not have the organ like roots, stems and leaves. So according to the presence and absence of flowers, they can be bifurcated into two types. We see different plants growing in different places around us. That is the land पे जो develop हो गए हैं वो plants हमको देखने को मिलते हैं. After that, in water also some aquatic plants are there. They can grow in the water only. Therefore, they are called as the aquatic plants. So we can say according to their living place, they can be bifurcated. Plants can be classified according to their habitat. Habitat, that is nothing but the place where they live or where they grow. Land, water, marshy areas, deserts and even a big tree are various habitats of the plants. Land, that is called as the plants, the trees which develop on the land, they are called as the terrestrial plants. The plants which grow in water, they are called as the aquatic plants. Marshy areas, that means where कीचड़, मतलब हमेशा वहां पे wet place, वाटर कंटेंट रहेगा, सॉइली एरिया हमेशा वेट रहेगा वहाँ का, कीचड़ जिसको हम बोलते हैं दैट इज द मार्शी एरियाज, डेजर्ट्स, इन डेजर्ट्स ड्राइनेस इज मोर, वाटर कंटेंट इज वेरी लेस, एंड इवन अ बिग ट्री, जो बड़े बड़े प्लांट्स होते हैं, वेरी बिग ट्रीज, ऑन दैट सर्टन स्मॉल प्लांट्स दे ग्रो, क्लाइंबर्स दे ग्रो, ओके, सो दीज आर द वेरियस हैबिटेट्स ऑफ द plants. Look at the diagram 3.5. So these are different criteria which can be used for the classification of the plants. Now next part, it is the diversity and classification of animals. In living things only plants are there? No, animals are there, insects are there, plants are there. Different animals have developed different shape to survive in the environment. There is a great variety in the body structure of animals too. The amoeba that cannot be seen with our eyes, the huge elephant, the small snail, the fish that swims in water, a kite that flies high in the sky, butterflies that flit around the flowers, a house lizard that crawls on a wall are all animals. So from smallest amoeba, amoeba it is a unicellular organism. So amoeba it is a very smallest species in animals which cannot observe with our eyes. We have to use the microscope for observing the amoeba. From that amoeba up to the huge elephant. Sabse largest animal kaun sa hai? Elephant. In between that, number of different animals are there. A small snail is there, fish that swims in the water, that means fish kya ho gaya? Aquatic animals ho gaye, kyunki wo water mein rehte hai. Only fish can live in water? No, others, many animals are there, starfish are there, many different tortoises are there, different species are there which can be live in the water, and therefore they are called as the aquatic animals. Butterflies that flit around the flowers. A house lizard which crawl on the wall. So each and every, here 5-6 examples are there. If you observe carefully the structure of that animals, you can be concluded that each and every animal have different characteristics. They have various organ system. Organ system that means whatever their body organs are there, there is a variety in that organ system, and through that organ system various functions inside their body occur. Alag alag functions body mein kaun se hote hai? Circulation hota hai, digestion hota hai, respiration hota hai, excretion hota hai. These are the different processes which occur inside our body, and for each and every process different organ system is there. So according to that also there is a lot of diversity. Diversity that means what I told you, variety. According to that there is a variety in animals. Look at the diagram, or you look at these different species. Tiger, honeybees are there, snails. Yes, if you observe carefully the structure, body structure of these animals, each and every animal have different body structure. Where food is available, they are found in that places. Different animals have different methods of obtaining and eating food. These two leads to the different in their body structure. So according to the capturing of food, according to the consumption of food, this is also the criteria to classify the different animals. Now if you observe the species like amoeba paramecium under the microscope, then these animals, these are the examples of unicellular organisms. Uni that means only one cell is there. In their body only one cell is there which control the all functions of their body. Therefore they are called as the unicellular organisms. And second one, it is the multicellular organisms. Multi that means many, more than one cell. according to the presence of cell, we can say that animals can be bifurcated into unicellular and multicellular. According to their body structure, animals can be classified in these types. According to the presence of cells, if one cell is there, unicellular. If many cells are there, then they are called as the multicellular. Next criteria it is, animals with a vertebral column and those without it form two groups. If you touch to the center of your back, a chain of bony structure you will find, and that bony structure, the chain of bony structure, it is nothing but the vertebral column. Very important part of our body. So that vertebral column, if it is present, then that animals are called as the vertebrates. And if that vertebral column is absent, then it is called as the invertebrates. This is the next criteria. Snakes, birds, fish, kangaroos, as also humans, are vertebrates animal. Why? Because vertebral column is present in these animals. And animals such as snails, cockroaches, earthworms do not have a vertebral column, and therefore they are invertebrate animals. Next criteria, it is the type of reproduction. According to that, animals can be classified as the oviparous and viviparous. What is the meaning? Let us see with examples. A hen lays eggs and hatches them. After a few days, the young chicks hatch out of the eggs. A cow gives birth to a calf. Before that, the calf grows within the cow's body. According to the mode of reproduction, animal can be classified into two types. Oviparous animals, which lay eggs, and viviparous animals, which give birth to their young ones. Example, cows, buffaloes, kangaroos, human beings, tiger. These all are the examples of the viviparous animal. So according to their habitat, animals are usually classified into terrestrial and aquatic animals. Terrestrial, that means they live on the land, and aquatic animals, that means the animals which live in water. However, animals like a frog, salamander, toad live in both places, namely land and water. Therefore, they are called as the amphibious animals. But inka special characteristics kya ho gaya fir? Ke ye water mein bhi survive kar sakte hai aur land par bhi survive kar sakte hai. A kite, an eagle, a crow, a butterfly, a honeybee all fly in the air, though they live in different places. Aerial mode means in air they fly. Because they can fly in air, therefore they are called as the aerial mode of life. What we have learned, plants are classified on the basis of their height and the shape of stems, period of life cycle and habitat. According to that, they can classify. And animals are classified on the basis of cell structure, vertebral column, method of reproduction and habitat. And according to that, animals can also classify. So in this lesson, we discussed about the classification of plants and animals with the help of different criteria. Read out the lesson completely, and if there is any difficulty regarding to that, you can ask me. Thank you.